So thanks for including our paper on the program. And this is joint work with Joey Engelberg, who's at UCSD, and Jeffrey Poniff, who's at Boston College. So a little bit of background and motivation, especially for those of you that aren't academics. So there's a good chunk of academic research that studies what I call the cross-section of stock returns. And so what I mean by this is that you can sort stocks on pretty simple, easy to observe characteristics like past sales growth, past stock returns, and you can actually predict future returns with that. So for example, stocks that had really high returns over the last 5 years tend to have low returns over the next 5 years. That's called long-term reversal. Small stocks tend to have higher returns than large stocks. Momentum, stocks that had high returns over the last 6 months tend to have high returns over the next 6 months. And so on. Firms that take large accruals in their accounting tend to have low stock returns going forward. Firms that announce really good earnings tend to have high stock returns over the next 90 days. Firms that announce kind of bad earnings relative to what was expected have low stock returns over the next 90 days. And so people, we sometimes refer to these as anomalies because if you study classic finance, you're not supposed to be able to predict stock returns except with risk. And it's not really obvious how these things are explained by risk, so we call them anomalies. And the research goes back at least to 1973, 43 years. This is a paper showing that low Bloom and Husick shows that low-priced stocks have high returns. I actually had an accounting professor correct me and say, no, there's an accounting paper in 1968, but that paper didn't have a T statistic. This one actually has a T statistic, and it's in Journal of Finance. So I guess maybe the first one's a finance paper, but there's a lot of these papers are in accounting journals too, I should say. And so the question that we try to deal with and everyone, so basically there's a branch of academic research that kind of documents these things and then likes to fight about what explains them. And so we're gonna try to weigh in on that, and we're gonna try to explain what explains the bulk of this cross-sectional predictability. And so there's three popular explanations. And so basically, the first is that this is just all kind of consistent with classic finance. This is called risk. I'll talk a little bit more about how that is. But basically all these things, so why do some stocks have high returns and some stocks have low returns? Well, high return stocks are risky and low return stocks are less risky, and that explains it. And just we academics don't know how to measure risk correctly. And if we did, we wouldn't be surprised by any of this. Examples of that, Gene Fama, who was a co-Nobel laureate with Professor Shiller, has written a lot of papers kind of claiming that. The second would be mispricing. And what's kind of fun about these is they're like the polar opposites of each other. So the mispricing explanation and the one that we'll kind of focus on in this paper, because there are several. So Barbaras and or more recent, a recent Nobel laureate, Richard Thaler, have written on this, that maybe these things reflect mispricing. So as an example, why do stocks with high sales growth have low stock returns? Well, maybe investors kind of naively extrapolate the past into the future. So a stock grew really fast over the last 5 years. I just think, wow, that must mean it'll grow really fast over the next 5 years. And then things mean revert. Some will continue, but a lot don't. And then we get news that it's not growing as fast as we thought it was going to grow, and we're disappointed, and we have low stock returns, and that explains it. So maybe all these different strategies are just kind of somehow correlated with these biased expectations investors have. And when those biases, when people kind of learn that they're wrong via news or other kind of financial information, they update, and that corrects the price, and that explains why you can predict returns. And then the last one we'll look at is data mining. That basically says, well, you have all these professors, running regressions on, we have 97 different strategies in our paper. People probably tried 2,000, 1,900 didn't work, and just by chance these 100 did, and that's what's going on here. So maybe that's kind of all it is. So what we're going to do in this paper, we're going to look at 97 different strategies. Usually combine them into one big variable. And then we'll look at firm-specific news. We'll look at firms that had news, Dow Jones news, and earnings announcements, and we'll try to use these kind of daily information events to differentiate between the three explanations. So a little more detail on the story. The risk story, and we'll call that kind of the discount rate story, and for, I guess, non-finance people in the room, if someone wants to value a stock, they need to have two pieces of information. You forecast your future cash flows, and then use something called the discount rate, where you discount those cash flows back into time. So in an efficient market, in like a rational expectations market where everything's working perfectly, stock returns on average should equal discount rates. So if a stock is really risky, people will give it a high discount rate, it has a high expected return. If a stock isn't that risky, it has a lower discount rate, a lower expected return. So what this story is, and I've always had a little trouble with it because it's kind of like everyone knows but the academics. But so investors are out there and they're using high discount rates for some stocks, low discount rates for other stocks. And those discount rates are correlated with a variable like sales growth. So for whatever reason, on average, investors think high sales growth stocks aren't that risky. We academics don't know how they're measuring risk. We discover that high sales growth stocks have low returns. We think it's an anomaly or mispricing, but it isn't. It's really risk. And for some reason, practitioners just won't tell us how they're measuring risk. But risk can kind of, you know, explain it. And so there's really no surprises here. All of this is kind of expected by rational investors. So it's surprising to the people writing papers. It's not surprising to everyone else. That's kind of the rational, you know, expectation story. And so if you were to, therefore, what comes out of that framework is that you shouldn't have, you know, different discount rates or different risk-related returns on different days. So if a firm announces its earnings, so if a stock's risky, it's just as risky on a non-earnings announcement day as an earnings announcement day. Or if a stock has a story in the newspaper or something, the stock doesn't really become risky on that day. So if we were to look at, say, a portfolio of, let's say this is sales growth, right? So we're going to sort stocks on their sales growth, and I'm supposed to buy stocks that have low sales growth. So those stocks are going to have higher returns, but they're not going to have any higher returns on, say, day zero, which is an earning announcement day, than any other day. They're risky stocks every day, so every day they have higher returns. Or they're low risk stocks every day, and every day they have low stock returns. It shouldn't matter if there's, you know, if we learn about earnings or anything else like that. At least, I mean, some stocks might have good news, some stocks might have bad news, but it kind of cancels out. So that's the kind of, you know, discount rate story, or the risk story. Now the mispricing story goes something like this: is that investors have systematically biased expectations of cash flows and cash flow growth. They expect too much from some stocks and too little from others. And these anomaly variables are correlated with those expectations. When new information comes out, investors update their belief. That causes prices to correct and the return predictability. This is an old story. It for whatever reason, I think in the finance literature, it kind of got ignored for a few decades, but now it's kind of become more popular. But even back in the 70s, you could find papers that were talking about this. So Bazu, this is a Journal of Finance paper in 1977, and it found that stocks with high P ratios have low stock returns. So why would a stock with a high price-to-earnings ratio have low stock returns? And Bazu argued, well, maybe investors are too optimistic about those stocks. So the prices are really high, and then when those stocks, new information comes out, investors said, oh, we were too optimistic, and that causes the low kind of stock returns. And that was Bazu's story for why stocks with high P ratios have low stock returns. And so we're going to see if we can apply that story to kind of just all of these anomalies in general. And so this story makes a very, very different prediction about what should happen around an earnings announcement or a news day. So what this says is that, so let's say I have a stock, so long means a stock that an anomaly strategy says to buy. So what this story says is, well, investors were expecting really, their expectations were too low for this stock, the blue line. And so when the stock announces earnings, investors are pleasantly surprised, the stock price jumps up, and that's what explains the anomaly returns. Or some other stocks, you know, investors were too optimistic, the orange line, and then when new information comes out about the stock, investors said, wow, we were too optimistic, and then you have a low stock return, and that explains why that group of stock has low stock returns. So basically, what this strategy says is that, okay, if you take one of these anomaly strategies and form portfolios on it, the portfolios are really only going to make you money on days when there's an earnings announcement or some other type of news. Whereas the risk story says, well, the portfolios should kind of do the same on every day. So the very kind of different in empirical predictions. Now the last one that could explain it is data mining. And when I started this project, I said, no, that's silly. We don't really need to deal with this. And then as we went through it, I learned I was totally wrong. And it's actually very hard to kind of reject this. So we actually had to do a lot of work on this. And so, you know, Fama points out, and others have, is that, you know, like I said, academics probably tested thousands of variables. It's not surprising that some of them would predict returns in sample. Other, you know, kind of sciences, you know, it's called like the multiple testing bias. People have, you know, recognized this in other fields and other sciences. It's been stressed, you know, more recently in the finance literature. You know, Cam Harvey and some others have papers on this. And I thought, well, if someone found something by data mining, it shouldn't have a higher return on an earnings announcement day or a news day. And I thought you could just dismiss this, but I you know, in hindsight, I was quite wrong. Most anomalies, you know, when people do these papers, they focus on monthly returns. But turns out, if you think about it a little bit, a stock that had a really high return in month T probably had really good news in month T. So if a stock had really high returns in January, it's probably because on one of those days in January, they announced really good earnings or they had some other really good news, and that's actually what explains it. So even if, for example, if you just sorted stocks on their past returns and say, let's look at the stocks that did the best last month, it's probably stocks that for some reason had good news last month. And so what this says is, like, let's say you thought of some ridiculous strategy. Like, let's just, you know, okay, we found that stocks that had that start with the letter Q had really high returns during the years 1990 to 2000. So there's no economic reason why that should happen, but if it did happen, it's probably that stocks that start with the letter Q just by chance also had good news during that period, and that's why they had high stock returns. A challenge for us then is if we find that anomalies have high returns on certain days, can we kind of control for this effect that you might find just randomly and then still differentiate between mispricing and data mining? Overall, our findings, I guess, like, at a first blush, it seems like it's probably hard to explain with risk, because if you form these portfolios on these strategies, they perform 7 times higher on earnings announcement days and 2 times higher on corporate news days. So really what explains these portfolio returns is just stocks in the portfolios having really good news or really bad news. It's not something that you're kind of earning consistently. This is like a plot of what we have. So the blue line is portfolios that the anomaly strategies say to buy. The red line are the strategies you're supposed to short. And these are 3-day windows around earnings announcement, and you can see there's just kind of a lot more action when there's, you know, earnings are announced. So the stocks that you're supposed to buy, investors are surprised, you know, pleasantly surprised. That's the blue line around earnings announcements, and stocks you're supposed to short, investors are disappointed. The earnings come in worse than what they expected. Now to get a better look at, is this really risk or mispricing or data mining, we also look at analyst forecast errors, because financial analysts forecast earnings. And so it also turns out that stocks that anomalies say you're supposed to buy, analysts forecasted earnings that were too low. The actual earnings come in higher than what analysts thought they were going to be. And stocks that these strategies say to short, analysts were forecasting, you know, too high. You know, the earnings came in lower than what they thought. So this is kind of, I guess, kind of comforting, because this can't have anything to do with the discount rate story I told you about. So to the extent that analysts are like the average investor, it looks like for whatever reason, analysts' expectations are biased too. They expect too little from the stocks anomalies say to buy, and they expect too much from the stocks that anomalies say to short. How do we interpret this? I'm biased. I mean, I have my own opinions, but I think it is still hard to tie these stock price reactions to firm-specific news to systematic risk. So I think it's hard to explain this with a discount rate story. When you try to explain it with risk too, you know, like a firm, also these strategies do worse on days when there's macroeconomic news. So on days when we have news about the macro economy, it aren't necessarily good days to trade on anomalies. And that for a variety of reasons is inconsistent with a lot of the risk models people have. Also, things that are supposed to be explained by risk should be very correlated with the market. But actually, if you trade these anomaly strategies, you're actually trading what's called a negative beta strategy. You tend to do better when the market does worse. And again, there's just not a lot, really any risk-based models out there that explain that. And then risk certainly can't explain the analyst forecast error result. The data mining strategy, again, that's a little bit harder to rule out, because like I said, an anomaly that you found just spuriously by data mining would perform better, at least in sample, on earning days and news days. What we do, and I'll show you a little bit in the paper, we're able to control for that and still show that anomalies do better on news days. So if I have 2 stocks and they both had a 10% return in the same month, I can show you that the anomaly stock earned more of its return on news days and earnings days than the non-anomaly stock. So that's one test we do. Another test we do is that fortunately we have a lot of out-of-sample data. So for these 97 strategies, a lot of them, so their sample was like 1980 to 2000. Well, good. So I have all this data from 2000 to 2017, and I can get the same result just using that out-of-sample, after the paper's published or after the author's sample ended. And so that probably can't be by data mining. And also we show that this is stronger in small stocks rather than large stocks, and that for a variety of reasons seems more consistent with mispricing than data mining. We think the results are most consistent with mispricing. They're pretty easy to explain with a simple behavioral theory of bias expectations. Just investors' expectations are too high for some stocks, too low for others. The anomaly variables are correlated with those. When new information causes investors to update their belief, price is correct, and then you see your return predictability. And the analyst forecast error results fit, you know, with this framework too. So that I guess that's our take, that probably mispricing is probably the best explanation for anomalies on average. Could be individual ones that don't fit that, but on average, that's probably what's going on. I'll just spend a little bit on our place in the literature. There are earlier studies that looked at anomaly returns, usually just a single anomaly on earnings announcement days. What we do that's different is we have pretty much the whole universe of published anomalies. And we also, instead of just earnings days, we use Dow Jones News Days, and there's 6 million of those that aren't just earnings announcements. And then we do things with analyst forecast errors, and we have some new data mining tests. So how do we choose the anomalies? Came from an earlier paper that I did with Jeff Poniff, that basically we pull things that are published in primarily the top three finance journals and the top three accounting journals. And we have to be able to construct them with the data that you know, academics have easy access to. And again, these are all just cross-sectional predictors. So we're not predicting a stock's return over time, we're just ranking stocks at a point in time and saying this group will outperform that group. That's what anomalies do. I'll just kind of move on with this. This is probably more detail than we kind of need here. We get our earnings announcements from CompuStat. We get corporate news days from the Dow Jones News Archive, data that Paul's, you know, one of our organizers here, has used in his work too. And so we have 40 million firm day observations where, you know, an individual stock and its returns on different days. And our sample period is from 79 to 2013. You can see, like in our sample, there's not a lot of earnings announcement days. Only 1% of the sample is earnings announcement days, but about 16% is news days. And about half our earnings announcement days are also news days. So how do we measure anomalies? What we do is we try to do something parsimonious. So instead of looking at all 97 individually, what we do is we just make one aggregate measure, and then we'll make kind of four sub-measures. And so what we do is every month we sort stocks on the different anomaly variables. So for example, take sales growth. So every month I'll sort stocks on their sales growth, and stocks with the highest sales growth, basically, you know, put them into quintiles. Those are the ones we're supposed to short, and stocks with the lowest sales growth, those are the ones we're supposed to buy. And so we just count up, we do that for every single anomaly, for every stock, every month, and we just make two variables called long and short. So in a particular month, long is the number of anomaly variables that say to buy the stock. Short is the number of anomaly variables that say to short the stock, and net is just the difference between long and short. So a net of 10 means there's 10 more anomaly strategies that say to buy the stock than to sell the stock. And so higher net means higher forecasted stock returns. And our, you know, the average stock in our sample has a net value of 0. It can range from, you know, minus 36 to positive 32. So what we do with our mean regression specification is just we have daily stock returns. And so what we do is we just ask the question, we do a regression of a stock return on our net variable. And really just the first three things here are the things that we're kind of most interested in. So we just ask, the stocks with higher values of net have higher returns? Do stocks with higher value of net have higher returns on earnings announcement days? Do stocks with higher value of net have higher returns on just any, you know, a Dow Jones news day? And then we control for, you know, a whole bunch of other stuff. And what we find, and it doesn't really matter, you know, we're just different, trying to control for all kinds of different things. It doesn't really matter what you control for, but if you look across the first row, so okay, you know, our anomaly variable works the way it should. Stocks that anomaly strategies say to buy have higher returns. And you can see that on an earnings announcement day, by a factor of almost, you know, 7 or 8, they have higher returns on a news day. So I'll interpret the coefficients in a little bit, but it's just higher returns on for anomaly stocks, much higher returns on earnings days, and then on Dow Jones news days, returns are also higher for anomaly stocks by about double. Earnings days are more of an effect than news days, but there's much fewer earnings days. And, you know, some stocks have lots of news, like Apple's in the news all the time, and a lot of it probably isn't really important for, you know, for their business. And we try to just include everything. We try to be very agnostic about what to include and what not to include. So we include in everything. We don't try to, like, throw out some news that we think might not be important. So we just include everything in there, even though we know a lot of it won't be important, but it still comes in significant. And just so economic interpretation, if you had a stock with a net value of 10, that means 10 more strategies, say, to buy the company than sell the company. On a non-earnings day, your daily basis points would be 2.59. That's an annualized return of about 6%. And on an earnings day, you're getting about 22 basis points. That's an annualized return of almost 76%. So most of the action from these anomaly strategies are coming on earnings days. How much time should I keep? Anyways, about five more? Okay. We then break up long and short separately, and we show that this can happen if you're just looking at long exposure. You know, it happens both on the long side and the short side. So basically, for stocks at anomalies say to buy, you find these effects, and for stocks at anomalies say to sell, you also kind of find these effects. Pretty symmetric. You can see that, so for example, stocks at anomalies say to short, you know, on an earnings day, you'd get an annual, on a non-earnings day, you get an annualized return of minus 5%, and on an earnings day of minus 72%. So, you know, bottom line, you're getting most of the action on days when there's earnings and also Dow Jones news. We control for a lot of different things. It's not explained by day of the week. It's not explained by macroeconomic news. You only get this with firm-specific news. It's not explained by volatility calling news, causing news. We break our anomalies into different types based on the type of information you know, needed to do the strategy. For example, like an analyst upgrade or a downgrade, or is the anomaly constructed with only accounting data or only past stock return data? It doesn't really matter. We can keep getting the same result. The last thing I'll kind of talk about, I think we're short on time, I'll skip the analyst forecast error, but I'll just briefly say that what this shows is that for stocks at anomaly strategy say to buy, analyst forecasts are too low. And for stocks at anomaly say to short, analyst forecasts are too high. Because the dependent variable in the regression is the difference between what the analyst forecasted and what was actually realized. The last thing I'll show you is just the data mining test. And basically what we're able to show is that, yes, it is the case that a stock that, say, has a high return in a particular month has higher returns on earnings days and higher returns on news days. But what we can show is that after controlling for that, so if you have two stocks with both have a 10% return, the anomaly stock will have a lower return on a non-news day and a much higher return on an earnings day or a news day. And then also, if we only look at anomaly strategies that are completely out of sample, so like the author's sample was, say, you know, 1970 to 2000, and we just look at data post-2000, we can get the exact same results. So for that reason, we're pretty confident it's probably not data mining. And we can do the similar test with analyst forecast errors and get the same result. So I'll conclude, but so there's about 43 years of evidence of this kind of, you know, anomaly or cross-sectional return predictability. People disagree on it. People, even after our paper and many other papers, I'm sure will still disagree on it, which is good for me because then I can keep writing papers on it. But our best guess of what's going on is that this is probably a behavioral finance explanation, that there's biased expectations. Investors expect too much from some stocks, too little from other stocks. When news or earnings announcements come out, investors kind of learn the update, and that's what causes the anomaly returns. So, yeah, thank you.